Struggle today as good and evil. Even though you're saved, you still struggle each and every day. All of the days struggle.
Amen.
You're not saying that you have a struggle, you're lying. Excuse the expression, you are. Because you have struggles. I don't care if you have a halo on your head, wings on your back.
Right.
You still struggle.
That's right.
Amen. You should struggle. So if I'm thinking about your mouth, it should come out. You still struggle. You're saved, I mean, it's still. Some sit by thought, it's not being number still, you're still struggling. Amen? You get mad calling your wife the devil, but she called you the devil, you're still struggling. Even though they're not the devil, because you said it was the devil. So you're still struggling with you, right? But this little story here, and I'm going to move on. Now, there was two boys. You know how boys are, they doing stuff, so they decided to. In the cemetery, there's a big tree with acorns growing. In the cemetery, there's a big tree. This little tree is full of acorns. Nobody is getting the nuts that fall off the tree. So we're going to go into this bucket, and we're just going to collect some acorns in the graveyard in the cemetery. So these two young men went in there, and they started to get a bucket full of nuts. They had it so full. So they began to divide. But they've got, you know, I used to grow some people's strawberries, blackberries on the side of the road. And we would get them at, we would split them, you know, divide them. So one of the boys said, I think what we'll do, since we got so many of our spoil, we're going to divide them. So we, the young man said, well, okay, how are we going to do it? So what can we do it like this? One for you, you know how we split, right? So we kept one for you, one for me. they're saying this, so a lot of them being rolled by on the vine. So we hear them saying, one for me, one for you. How do you wake up? Everybody agree about the day, right? You know, little folks agree about that, the cemetery, they did. But he heard this voice from the cemetery. He said, my goodness, what's going on in the cemetery? I heard this voice, but I don't see no one. So he stopped to investigate. So he, in his mind, he said, I know what it is. It's the devil and God divided up the soul. The devil said, one for me. The Lord said, one for me. The devil said, one for me. The Lord said, one for me. So he read it back. He said, I got to tell somebody. I got to find a friend. Tell somebody the devil and God is on a struggle. And he said, one for me. So somebody's going to hell and somebody's going to heaven. So he found an old man struggling along, walking like a big breed, not quite as fat, being struggling, but his cane. So the young man came and told what had happened. So the old man, of course, played with his mind. I want to meet the devil. I never met the devil before. So he went to the cemetery, and before he got to the fence was there, so he got to the fence, he started stepping before the young man. So now he kept saying, one for me, one for you. He said, yes, I want to see that devil. I got to see this devil come. I never seen him. One for me, one for you. So after they had counted all some nuts and rolled down to the fence, you remember it was two at the end of the fence, right? The old man and the Lord. So when they said, come on, we're going down to get them two nuts. So the old man and the young boy started talking about them. And they thought God and the devil was coming at them. What did they do? What would you do if the devil comes to you? You flee, you ran, right? The old man was so like he wasn't saved, he just knew he was going to hell. And the young boy came going to help you, right? Does somebody else? I'm going to help him. So, saint, you don't know where you're going. You don't know if you're going to heaven or to hell. Because the devil got one for him and one for the Lord. And the day of separation, he gonna separate the goats from the sheep, right? So that's why as saints of God, you gotta know where you're going. And who you going with. Do you choose heaven or you choose hell? That's your choice. That's your choice. You can choose to go with God, and you can choose to go with the devil. But only you can make that decision. You can write to your friends, I'm saying, or you can write to your friends, I'm going to hell. It's up to you. The struggle is between you and your God. Not between your pastor and your deacon or whoever. Your struggle is not with your wife or husband. Your struggle is between you and the devil. Where are you going? Heaven or hell? Y'all understand it today? But it's totally up to you. You need to say whom you will serve. Are you going to serve the Lord? You enjoy the pleasure of sin? The Bible says the pleasure of sin is what? For a season. And Elder Roth was telling me yesterday about this young lady who took her life and left three kids because of a struggle. Feel like this would be the end, but that's not the end you take life. That's just the beginning. But so many young folks are taking their lives because they can't cope. They take the cowardly way out, take their life, but they're leaving other people in perils. That's true. You're leaving family behind, children behind. That's the cowardly way out. Not only that, you are creating problems because most people that do that don't have insurance to bury themselves. That's creating another problem. But only had trust God. You don't have to be saved to trust God, but you got to trust Him, saints. He knows what's best for us. He knows what's best for you. But the enemy wants to overwhelm you with problems and situations. He compounds the problems. And you are so overwhelmed, you don't know what to do. And all they do is flee. Because the pressure is so great. And I'm not saved folks. I'm not talking about the world. But you have learned to put your trust in God. got to find a way to overcome your struggle. He says, when I put more on you, you can bear. But the enemy is always trying to intensify the pressure. He's always got, look at him, like Job. He won't stand. He'll curse you. And he put the pressure on God, put the pressure on you. And that's the way the enemy does. Even family members. Sometimes you have a time or tough time. Family members, what are you doing wrong? What you said wrong? If you had to do this, this would happen. If you had done this, this would happen. And they put all this pressure on you. And before you know it, the pressure is so overwhelming, you think about the worst thing. But not the other part of our God. When you become overloaded with a problem, you have to get rid of some stuff, right? A plane has a weight limit. So that weight has to be precise, else it won't get off the ground. Or if it gets off the ground, the weight will cause it to come back down. Because of the weight. So they, everything, the weight, the loadmaster job is to make sure the fuel is correct. The number of people passing up, everything has to be correct, has to balance. If you put too much on it, it's going to come down. You got fuel, you got people, only aircraft. So everything has to be calculated to the precise number, and sometimes they get to the problem and it dumps some fuel. Amen?
Amen.
So all these things, is it Brother Chris?
Yes, sir.
That's the miracle right there.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Chris is a walking miracle.
Amen.
And we just went to see him, and I was told he was just as happy. And he was laying that way on a kidney and a heart. And all they could keep Brother alive was the machine. And he was talking to me and ministered to me. I was being blessed by him. And now he went to see his son, then his great ladies. And I asked, of course, how did this man, this ministry, I think he had three stripes. I said, well, God advanced him. You don't get three stripes in David, you just don't need him. Unless you have some credentials. Amen. God had favored him. Give God praise. Amen. So the struggle is going on in the church. We are struggling with personalities. We struggle with money. We struggle with good pastors, good musicians. We struggle with good people. It's a constant struggle. Life is full of ups and downs, and balance, and peace. And I don't talk about you, but through some sometimes.
Amen.
Sometimes it's your health.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You're well, you're doing good. And all of a sudden things change. And you're in a struggle with your health, your physical body. Sometimes you're in a struggle with your mind. Paul's in a struggle. But behind every struggle, the devil is involved some kind of way.
Right.
So he and Paul was yet threatening. And he was breathing out threatening and slanders against the disciple of the Lord. Look at your neighbor, you've got a pick your fight. So he didn't know who he was against. Sometimes Paul, he didn't realize that he was fighting against God instead of God's people. So the enemy comes against you, he'll realize that he is fighting against a force he can't see.
Yes.
He's fighting of the God that is free, the God that knows everything.
Yes.
The God has all power. He doesn't see God, but God is in the midst. Even when you're going through, God sees what you're going through. God is there. God wants to see what you're going to do in the midst of the struggle.
Yes.
Sometimes the pressure gets so intense that you feel like you're going to lose your mind.
Yes.
Anybody been there besides me?
Yes.
But Because in your groaning, God understands even your groaning.
That's right.
When you're going through your camp, even in church, I've been in church sometimes, and I couldn't even feel the presence of God. But I was still in the house. And my mind was in the house. I let my trouble get me down. But I would lift my head and say, hallelujah, in it. I'm not letting my situation turn my plate. I said, hallelujah. Situation. I mean, share it. They don't understand it. And people would, and you know, it got to a point, I expense and still I invest in church now. But I got to a point. I said, I'm going to give this car back, a new car, at 2005 Chrysler. I carried it back to the man's ear that I can't pay for. Because the church was on my mind to keep the church going. But people had left the church, and we were going to struggle, and I had to, we were just fighting, trying to keep afloat. And my wife said, well, I'm going to the bank and tell them we can make it and drop a note. I said, they're not going to drop the note. They're not going to do that. They dropped that note from $8,000 to $2,200. That's how you stay in this building. God did. That was a deal impossible. And churches and pastors wanted to come in and take over the ministry. We had people wanting to say they won't be there long. We get the bill of enough. But look at God. Y'all didn't know what I would tell nobody. And sometime on Wednesday night, it'd be my wife and me and Dick Turner's wife. That's all was here. In this big building. We kept on praying. People were waiting on fall. Waiting on fall. I was in a struggle. And I never forget, I came in here one day and I said, Lord, this is the bank's well, we're going to foreclose at 1 o'clock. I was at work, but it just told me up. Lord, I can't do anything else. They called me back 5 minutes later. They said, okay, Mr. Fowler, come over here. We had it worked out. I drove to Winston, and the banker told me, he said, well, Mr. Reed's too old. You have to sign for everything. So I put my life on the line for you. I signed the mortgage to keep you in this building. That means they could come out and pay for everything I own if you're going to fail. Because I was the guarantor for the law. Signed the note. But the bank wanted a person to own a building. Because a building can sign for itself, it has to be an individual to sign a guarantor for the loan. If you're going to be there. All those things, y'all know what? I lost weight. I went down from 200 pounds. I went down to 138 pounds. I was skinny bone. It was so heavy on me. Yeah, they were down here taking a word. Sister Jackson encouraged me. She said, at that time, Elder Fowler said, what if you were going to lose everything? She didn't know I was going to struggle. But the words she spoke to me, God put you in this pastor for this reason. She said that, and that was confirmation that I held on to. A lot of times I want to walk away and say, we'll be honest. I said, I don't deserve this. It ain't my building. It's not my deal. And but the enemy talks to you when you're in a struggle. You tell you all the things. You get rid of it, hey, walk away. Ain't your problem. I mean, he does all that to us. But through the struggle, you got to fall down on your knees and ask God for direction. Many times. And every time I went through a little struggle, and in the middle of the struggle, you know God is smarter than me. Like I said, if I had a brain, I'd be awesome. I had a good brain. I'd be a terrible person. But God spoke to me. Just like I'm speaking to you right now. He spoke to me very specifically. Said, look, the church is my wife. You take care of your wife. I'll take care of my wife. I said, Lord, thank you. I'm going to take this to serve you having a church. And don't you know, from that day, from that moment, my burden was lifted.
Hallelujah.
I had burden since.
Thank you, Jesus.
Then all of a sudden, the saints caught on fire.
Thank you, Jesus.
The saints are moving. The saints are blessing. And it got to a point, all I do was stand back and the saint began just work. I said, Saints, we don't want to be selling hot dogs, we don't want to be selling hamburgers, we don't want to be selling stew. I said, we don't want to be selling nothing, we should be giving away stuff. I said, we don't need to, for the world to support our ministry. We chapter all around about his people. Saying, I'll be how low you get. God, got somebody gonna bless you. Somebody get about to pray.
Yeah!
like that, stood beside me and say, thank you, Jesus. God blinded him. No one could see. Paul couldn't see. No one was with him. So bright that only could just hear voice.
Oh, yes.
Sometimes your storm is so bright, all they can do is hear voice. Well, the voice is that to encourage you, not with you. I'm right there by your side. That's encouraging. Glory to God.
All right.
you imagine what you would do if you put the will in your life, the will to do? All you need is the will to do. That's why people come to the United States and become millionaires and billionaires, because they see the will to do. The struggle in other countries, if you're in the military, like Frank and I, didn't want to be in the military, I think Brady and Brother Jack, when you see other folks, you grow up in the military with people all races, all sizes, and you and everybody's competing for the same goal. Who's going to get the next strike? Who's going to get the next promotion? So you learn to be competitive in a big, big organization. So that push and drive that the military give you, succeed, accomplish a mission at any cost. You're going to have a casualties, you're going to lose something. But accomplish a mission. Amen. The great thing to talk about it. And you bring that, I'll never forget my number RA, that's regular army, 129-82662. After 51 years, I never forgot that. My number. Don't turn on the use. Probably with something else damn different. But the RA 129-8662, that was regular army, and the U.S. was drafted. The military orders, a lot of them forgot that, but getting rid of all those orders. Some things you'll never forget when you have a will to succeed. When I come to this church, I have a will to succeed. And that means the best I can be for the Lord. I fail, that's a struggle. But one thing about it, I'm still struggling. Still struggling.
All right.
Sometimes I struggle to even preach, I'll be out of breath. Still struggling. I mean, you get older, you don't get in this long. You don't have more dealing with all day. I can't do it. Don't expect me to holler. Like,